pure. I shouted from the rooftops, how long must I wait till I see your smile? I'm out of the moonlight, caught up in the sparkle in your eyes. So wicked, and I know I should go slow, but it's not.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Plutocracy Report on PRN. I'm Vince Marcanti, your host, and I hope you all are doing great and living healthy and informing the sheepies. Well, what's been going on? I mean, we had some crazy weather going on a couple weeks ago. Actually, almost every week this winter, there's an unusual storm that passes through with a warm side and then a cold side on the back. I'm concerned about what summer is going to bring in this new world of unequivocal climate change and geoengineering. Here in Chicago, we're getting some above-average temperatures this week, but for a while now, we basically live in Canada, where their cold air is coming down on us all the time since the subtropical jet stream meanders on this wavy pattern after it breaks apart off the coast. And quite often now, and y'all know, I suspect jet stream disruption is being used, you know, via ionosphere heaters. And I wish we could just take back our government and military and have the truth to every secret operation admitted to and move on to intelligence and rationality in applied science, technology, and governance. And I wish it could happen this week, but you know, it's hard to keep hope. I know, y'all, but I don't want to give up. I know it's improbable, but like I always say, it's not impossible. It's just organization and action we need. It doesn't take superhuman ability to overthrow the plutocratic power structure. I mean, you know, it would be nice if we had Superman to help us, but we don't. I never liked that superhero crap. Do you all like that? I mean, if you got superpowers, I'm not impressed if you win a fight. It should be easy. You know, if you save the world as a mere mortal, that I respect, if you do it with intelligence. And, you know, if someone out there does like that superhero stuff, don't get mad at me. You know, so what if we disagree on stupid stuff? I think I may have turned off and lost half of our audience because I don't like much of anything. And, you know, I make fun of Elon Musk, for example, because I don't trust him or think he does anything right. And I just don't like the guy. But I notice a lot of people do, and they get mad at me for insulting him. Whatever, get over it. We only need to agree on making a better society and ending plutocracy. That's all that really matters. So what if we have different opinions on minor things? As long as we are both kind and we want a better system, it's all good, y'all. And I'm not saying that just because I'm afraid of losing the rest of our listeners. Well, maybe a little bit. Because, you know, I insult just about everyone in the public eye, and they probably deserve it. But, you know, well, whatever. I do what I do, and I don't want to hold back, and I won't. So, back to the environment. I mean, Earth's climate is changing at an unprecedented rate, and this is undeniable. With each passing year, there are increasing occurrences of record-breaking temperatures, species going extinct, weird-looking skies, and strange weather occurrences, some that seem, you know, very likely to be a result of geoengineering. And how about that bomb cyclone a couple weeks ago? I mean, that's a new term on me. And now, you know, last week they were talking about massive record-breaking flooding in Nebraska, and it's going on in other states too, including Wisconsin with all the snow melting so quick. Extreme environmental conditions will increase due to climate change and geoengineering. So, you know, I think it was last week I was listening to this Dar Jamal guy on the Ralph Nader Radio Hour, and this guy's been on a lot of people's show talking about ice melting and trying to sell a book he wrote. you know, well, he's saying ice melts when things get warmer. You know, imagine that. I guess he wrote a book. And it's good to let people know, as the cryosphere further diminishes, it ain't good for us. You know, to me, it's all a big no crap. And everything he said on the show, I've known for a long time. But again, I guess most people aren't aware of the severity of this situation we are in. So, you know, good for him, even though he gives predictions that are very conservative, you know, and timelines, like you would expect if you want to appeal to a wider audience, because the truth is hard to swallow, and you'll be called an alarmist or a doom and gloom goon if you speak reality. But I gotta say, this guy pissed me off, because Ralph asked him about geoengineering, of which apparently he knows nothing about. And this Dar guy is like, well, geoengineering is just ideas that are being talked about, like inflating a big balloon to put up in the sky and block the sun, or scatter some harmless sulfate aerosols into the stratosphere to block a little sun. Maybe sometime in the future they'll do it, because they're just talking about it. Yeah, okay, Dar. Did you do some intense research on that? Or, you know, did you get that from Wikipedia, buddy? If you don't know what you're talking about, just admit it. Say, I don't know. Or shut the hell up about it. Did you know that evidence suggests the nanoparticles that scientists are already using to try to stabilize the climate include high concentrations of toxic aluminum? They are already doing it, sheepie. In fact, a groundbreaking scientific study led by Dr. Marvin Herden, a nuclear chemist and geochemist, found evidence of geoengineering activity that has occurred for at least 15 years. The geoengineering activity via tanker jet aircraft in places a non-natural, toxic substance in the Earth's atmosphere, which results in the release of large amounts of aluminum nanoparticles. So it's much worse than simply the disruption of the hydrological cycle, which is bad, of course, and it further deteriorates the ozone layer. That's, of course, terrible. But let's get control of our government and end this secret crap.
No, Vince, that's conspiracy, because the government never conducts projects in secret.
Oh, and the obvious negative effects it will create would deter them from ever trying this, right?
And they seek our consent to do anything first. Oh, okay.
How stupid and naive does that sound? It's like saying, I got a vaccine, but it only works if you get one too. Herd immunity, more like herd stupidity.
Even if you believe they didn't start geoengineering yet, you know, that they are about to start it. I mean, it's actually admitted to in the public right now. So let's take back our government to stop them and deal with saving our habitat rationally and without price tags and special interests. We can all agree on the main point, and we can unite to end this insanity of plutocracy. In the meantime, we are inhaling aluminum nanoparticles, and high levels of aluminum have been found in 80% of people tested for toxicity.
Of course, they just don't know why.
But all we can do while we wait for a rationalist revolution and have sanity brought back into our system of governance and an end to secrecy, we really should be thinking about trying to detox ourselves before we get brain disorders. Now, I haven't tried anything yet, you know, just a healthy diet and exercise, but I recently read that zeolite, which is a volcanic mineral, that it can help remove the heavy metals and aluminum. So, you know, I don't know where to get it yet, but I'm going to look into it, and I'll let you know when I learn more about it. And if anyone out there knows of a better detox, let me know. Well, let's keep our eyes up and open the summer and see what's going on as our habitat is further decimated by our system of greedy unsustainability of profit at all cost.
Climate change and geoengineering is such a difficult subject to talk about, you know, because it's so enraging. And people still think it's a political debate. But keep talking about it because it matters to all of us. All right, I'm going to move on to something perhaps a little bit less infuriating, the ongoing plutocrat coup in Venezuela. I want to get to the main point on this because out there in the alternative media, where we can actually find some facts, you know, they can tell you about the details and the history of petropolitics and U.S. imperialism. But I just want to tell you what's going to happen and what I think will not happen. We have to stop saying there will be an invasion and war ordered by our head sock puppet of sheer buffoonery, the Trumpster, because we may be wrong again, and that empowers delusional Trumpies, who actually would be in favor of war against the evil socialist commies, at least in most cases. I mean, do Republicans ever oppose war? I mean, some who are even old enough to remember the Vietnam War still believe what they are told. But the American empire of finance and dollar domination is in the end stage of decline, of protracted collapse. And holding that off for as long as possible is the main concern of the plutocrats. I'll bet some older people are like, well, good. I don't want to deal with any collapse in my lifetime. Let it happen after I die. I don't care. Well, it's closer than you think. And we need to address the cancer like brave rationalists, not cowards hoping to avoid our responsibility. But I don't think there's going to be a war. I mean, there isn't diplomatic support for a U.S. invasion of Venezuela. Even among the rich Venezuelans who support the U.S. puppet Juan Guaido, they don't want bombs dropping in their country. They just want a transfer of power. War is not an easy option for the plutocrats anymore, and most people don't approve of it. Trump is being presented as a man fighting the deep state, and he's trying to end wars, you know. He got us out of Syria, and he's talking with North Korea, and is winding down the Afghan war, you know, even though they're just privatizing the occupation there. The righty sheepies have to believe he is making decisions. I mean, really making decisions, and fighting the evil Democrats who are the war party now, and that's true. They love the neocon plutocracy agenda just as much as Republicans. But things are different now. I mean, the loss in Syria was a turning point, and because of the world waking up slowly but steadily, the plutocrats can't risk another military quagmire, humanitarian disaster, and defeat. Now, I don't think we will even invade Iran anymore. Now, the Zionists may do something horrible, and we will back them up. You know, the dumb Trump even admitted our foreign policy is basically just having Israel tell us what to do. But we are not in the war-conducting stage anymore. There is and will be trade war and economic war, of course, and nefarious covert operations to overthrow leaders we don't like. And we will never give up hurting the Venezuelan economy until we get our way. Or, you know, hopefully we are defeated by rational world consensus, you know. Like, for instance, maybe countries will start disobeying U.S.-imposed sanctions, no longer fearing us as the empire further declines. Which is also scary because the plutocrats won't be gracious losers and let us rebuild our country. Oh, we give up. Go ahead and take over again. They would start a freaking nuclear war before they abandon ships like rats. This is why we must gain control of our government by 2020. At least by, you know, November of 2020. And no one in the political arena is going to do that for us. So we have to do it ourselves. And the more we pretend Trump is in charge and the focus of our attention is on him or the Democrat candidates, we just empower the plutocrats more. So, anyways, we are seeing nefarious and evil covert acts to get our way instead of invasion. You know, so a few weeks back, they attacked the power grid. This is from Global Research.
The hybrid war on Venezuela just took a dark turn, literally, after the U.S. used cyber weapons and insider sabotage to attack the country's power grid last week, cutting off most of its electricity and creating a chain reaction of negative consequences all throughout the Bolivarian Republic, according to unverified reports cited in one of RT's recent articles on the topic. The Gray hydroelectric power plant, which provides 80% of the country's power, failed, possibly due to a cyber attack.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's for sure a cyber attack.
Which was followed by an explosion at the Sidor substation that was sustaining most of the country's power in the aftermath of the aforementioned.
Wow.
Well, good for them for using hydropower anyways. The nationwide blackout undoubtedly led to a worsening of living standards for Venezuela's over 31 million people, affecting everything from the availability of food supplies to hospital services and creating an insecure environment that proved irresistible for looters. Though it's unclear at this moment whether the majority of the citizens believe the American narrative that their own government's incompetence and corruption is to blame.
Yeah, whatever. Now, I heard Max Blumenthal say he didn't witness looting, and the people handled this far better than we would expect in many first world countries. But, you know, I heard Rat Boy
Marco Rubio
making fun of the people suffering from the power outage and childish tweets, and some of us were reminded of
Hillary Clinton
laughing about the rape and murder of Gaddafi, as well as
Madeleine Albright
saying 500,000 dead Iraqi kids from our sanctions
was worth it.
Now, there is no doubt we caused this power outage in my mind, and the political and news media puppets play their propaganda games, so most don't even care about the truth. They're just doing their jobs like good little sheepies. Some free market freaktard named
Professor Steve Hanke
said this.
With no food, electricity, or medicine, hospitals in Venezuela are closer to the 1800s than 2019. This is what a socialist society looks like.
Come on. Is there any doubt who is responsible for this? With these idiots saying things like that? It's time to shut these callous conservative crap heads down. We can't sit by and be a force of pure evil anymore. It's time to stand and defeat this plutocrat cancer, or die trying. So everything in the mainstream news is plutocrat propaganda and distraction, and let's hope that doesn't hold up much longer. All right, so I predict no invasion, but we will continue to perpetrate covert acts of horror upon the people of Venezuela, and perhaps get arms to some paid provocateurs to start shooting at cops and cause mayhem until their rat boy puppet,
Guaido,
gets in power. Now, I could be wrong.
But that's very rare, folks.
Now, you know, I had to pre-record this because I'm going out of town. And if they invade before the show is aired, I'm going to look like a dumbass.
But hey, it won't be the first time.
And I'm here to speak my mind, not be careful with my words and predictions. All right, enough of that. On to changing the American sheepie paradigm. All right, still to this day, too many people think putting people out of work is a bad thing and automation will destroy society. Putting people out of work means
we will all become homeless and die or turn into a socialist dystopia where the state will have total surveillance and control over you.
As if they don't already in a plutocratic dystopia.
We will either die from loss of work or suffer under a socialist dictatorship because we will have to give people stuff for free.
And that's bad.
How about being rational and humane? You know, a new way, not yet implemented by humankind, a cooperative society that is managed by the people's consent and everyone is presented with unbiased truth by law. No more deceptive leadership from the top down. I mean, Trump says socialism is a totalitarian dictatorship. Fine. So we create a government of the people. You can't call it socialist when we create a direct democracy and give people a universal basic income. How about that, you capitalist idiots? I mean, words like capitalist and socialist are meaningless when you understand we need systemic change to create a new monetary and economic system to survive. And as soon as someone mentions the old useless tag words, they have to be told that they are not yet able to think clearly. Their mind is captured by manufactured bias and can only see things dichotomously and through historical associated memory. Therefore, they aren't free-minded and creative enough to envision an entirely new social structure. You know, I'm not saying it's hopeless forever for them, because they can break that programmed paradigm, but they have to be willing to help change the system. And I'm afraid it will take a bad event before they question or lose faith in the government and this incredibly defective system we still, to this day, uphold. We are supporting pure malevolence, and we are accomplices by our consent, or at least indifference and inaction to change it. People are made to be incredibly narrow-minded. Some of them sound very intelligent and use big words, but they're just narrow-minded fools because they have no creativity. My point is that most people are seeing loss of jobs due to obsolescence via automation or anything else as a terrible thing. They can't imagine a rational society that sees automation as a gift from our technological advancements and freeing us to work less and enjoy our lives more. Like, it could be an irrational, cooperative society that they can't envision. They think this is all there is, as good as it gets. There are even a few tiny and insignificant examples of rationality going on today. You know, like I read how some unemployed Appalachian coal miners were trained to be beekeepers. Here it is. The declining coal industry has left nearly 100,000 former miners unemployed in West Virginia. But a new nonprofit called the Appalachian Beekeeping Collective hopes to bring new, more eco-friendly industry to the region. Beekeeping. The charity was founded with funds from a $7.5 million settlement from a lawsuit against a coal mine company for violating the Clean Water Act. I'm sure that's been overturned in Great Again America! That money has been used to fund environmental restoration projects and to develop sustainable economic opportunities in the once-thriving region that now has the highest unemployment rate in the country. So far, the collective has trained 34 former coal miners as beekeepers and will train 50 more in a few weeks. Imagine that. I thought coal miners could only do that job for the rest of their life. No, it turns out people can actually learn to do different things. All we have to do is give people the resources to live, learn, and thrive for free. Everyone, and I mean everyone, can be a helpful contributor to society with rational central planning within an egalitarian and participatory society, and use government, which just means pooled resources, to provide all job training and have useful and helpful jobs unlike today. The sheepies will call that socialist because that's all they know, but explain to them this is something that has never been done before, so old labels don't apply. We never had a self-governed society, nor a rational economy based on resources and personal community participation. I mean, that is true value. People struggling in this plutonomy economy feel helpless. Some commit suicide because they see nothing getting better in their future, and they get very depressed and feel hopeless. You know, in a system that I am proposing, everyone will feel good about helping our communities, and everyone will be allowed and encouraged to participate. It makes so much sense in every freaking way. Your personal, your personal contribution to your community is the value of the currency in your account. And pay structure will still vary, of course. You know, a surgeon will get more per hour than a custodian, but it will be a rational pay scale. Like, a CEO won't make 3,000 times more than their employees, like now, and everyone gets the same basic income just for being a citizen, because that gives them the basic rights we all deserve and can provide at this technological stage. And we can have a tax system of rationality as well. You know, just one tax on income at the same percent for everyone. I mean, imagine how stupid, useless, and detrimental jobs would be eliminated in a system of, you know, free of financial one-upmanship and intrinsic corruption, like in this horrible free market system run by plutocrats. Think of how crime would virtually disappear in this type of society I'm talking about. Also, free training in a field they choose to work in, and if they can't figure it out, they can be recommended for one, and everyone will be able to contribute to their society and pay back, which is what everyone will want to do. I mean, there is no human nature for laziness, like they always say, or war and cruelty. Our human nature adapts to and reflects the environment and society we live in. Period. It's the truth. It's obvious. We only think this insane culture is human nature because it's all we have known. But we could change it, or at least start the transition for the kiddies to have a chance. Now, I know most of you out there, deep down, feel it's crazy to think we can willingly change to what I'm suggesting. Well, okay. If we let plutocracy run its course, we are still going to have to confront the inevitable collapse, and that's not far off. It's obvious. So what can we do now while we try to teach people to see reality and be rational and revolt? Well, we can become a friction to the machine. Don't play their game. Move your money out of the big banks and the market and buy only useful and healthy things. You know, boycott Amazon and Walmart, burn less gas, go solar, go vegan, grow food, live small, and be happy. And don't participate in the plutocrat-captured institutions. You know, tell kids not to join the military or law enforcement until it is there to truly serve and protect us. Like, I just heard that cops taking money off people, which is called asset forfeiture, has surpassed the amount of money lost in all burglary. So the cops steal more than burglars now. We can't participate to systems that must change, or they never will. Like I said, I think the young people should all stop paying their student loans and, you know, destroy the system. I think kids should also boycott the for-profit colleges entirely. I mean, if they keep paying and going into debt, nothing is going to change. Action must be taken. I mean, perhaps it's smarter in America to forego college and empower yourself with knowledge in a field that interests you. You know, if you want to be a surgeon or a pilot, you're going to have to pay big bucks for instructions and hands-on training. But there are so many things you can learn and do on your own if you have the desire and self-motivation and decent level of learning ability. You know, be an apprentice. Learn a helpful trade or a trade school. You know, instead of a useless class on economics or politics or history, and a world doesn't need any more goddamn lawyers. And we don't need for-profit jails. We need a true justice system. And we need equality. Hence, that would bring less crime and less legal crimes against humanity. You know, judges, cops, lawyers, businessmen, and politicians commit those type of legal crimes. Self-education should be considered by employers as much as purchased credentials. And we may be approaching that time. The move to demonize change is in full gear. First, it is framed in a way that calls any humane notion of change socialism, which means
totalitarian insane dictators like Stalin or Pol Pot and starvation.
And
of course, an all-powerful state.
So now any suggestion of progressive governmental change is labeled as socialism. And it can only be viewed in historical terms. Nothing new can ever be discussed because it's all labeled as
been there, done that, and it failed, so this is the best we can do.
That's all anti-change propaganda. And even the sheepies themselves regurgitate it. You notice that? It's sickening. They're just programmed to parrot what they hear in the propaganda world. So even the so-called socialists in government, they just suggest tiny incremental modifications
in a decade or two within the existing system of plutocracy.
That is all any lefty-sounding Democrat can use as a platform, you know.
Oh, we're for campaign finance reform. Yeah, how about ending campaign finance and everyone gets the same public paid platform?
I mean, even for people who believe voting can change things, isn't it clear that the voting system is rigged in many ways? And they can do whatever they want. I mean, they could have reversed the results of Alexandria Cortez, but a few decent-sounding people are allowed to win House seats because they are needed to create the illusion of democracy, and they're never going to make any change anyways. And, you know, excuse me, the Republicans need someone to make fun of, and the lefties need someone to believe in. Well, we need to believe in ourselves, and we can govern ourselves and understand we should control our own communities and vote on the issues that affects us all. Direct and true democracy, free of plutocrat propaganda. I mean, lefties still believe a more lefty will change things, you know, like
B.S. Bernie Sanders.
Really? Did you know he votes for war like all the rest of them? He votes for billions in military aid for Israel and Egypt, bombing in Syria and Iraq, and regime change of democratically elected leaders. And he was all in favor of destroying Libya, the scumbag he is. Someone should have stood up and said this is crazy. He certainly didn't. He voted for every Bush wartime defense budget. He was in favor of using military force every time the plutocrats demand it. From Somalia in 93, Iraq 98, Kosovo, Yugoslavia, Afghanistan. He loves the military-industrial complex of pure evil, and his domestic ideas have no plan for real systemic change. Just some incremental and minor band-aids for a gaping wound of plutocracy, which will never be implemented anyways, unless the plutocrats want to implement it to save their own asses, which is what may happen. I mean, when things get bad, they will pretend they have the solutions, and that frightens me. I hope we don't fall for that again and end their reign of terror. Don't think we can support one political puppet and save our country. We have to do it ourselves. Get involved. Whoa, I better shut up for a few minutes because I'm going to forget to play a song if I don't. And this is a good one, and I already went past the halfway point already. Well, we know things are bad out there. In fact, the whole freaking world is on fire. So let's try to do our part. Tell us about it, Sarah McLachlan.
Light is falling amongst the living and the dying, and I'm trying. straight line on this short run. The more we take, the less we become. The fortune of one man means less for some.
That's a beautiful song, and she is a cool, talented, and attractive woman from Canada, and has a great voice to boot. She has a brilliant line in that song that goes, "The more we take, the less we become, a fortune of one that means less for some." World on Fire from her album Afterglow back in 2004. She's around my age, just a couple years older, so, you know, maybe she'd like to hang out with me sometime. You know, since we're peers and both musicians. Yeah, right, Vince. Dream on, dummy. Well, thanks, Sarah. That's a great song, sister. Keep singing it. All right, let me get back to scaring and depressing you, because
that's what I do best, baby.
Well, you know, at least I give a little hope that we can change things.
Mixed in with my doom and gloom.
All right. Well, I read something back in 2014 that was written by Tom McKay. And I will critique as we go, you know, like I always do.
Civilization was pretty great while it lasted, wasn't it?
No, actually, it wasn't all that great for a lot of people. Oh, boy, that didn't take long, did it?
Too bad it's not going to for much longer. According to a new study sponsored by NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, we only have a few decades left before everything we know and hold dear collapses.
Okay, so I guess they think collapse is around 2044. So that means 2024 is more realistic, because egg-headed projections are always overly optimistic, and they have to admit it eventually. It goes on.
The report written by applied mathematician Staffa Motashari of the National Socio-Environmental
Synthesis Center. That was a tough one to say.
Along with a team of natural and social scientists, explain that modern civilization is doomed. And there's not just one particular group to blame, but the entire fundamental structure and nature of our society.
Oh, you think? I thought just Republicans were to blame.
Analyzing five risk factors for societal collapse, population, climate, water, agriculture, and energy, the report says that the sudden downfall of complicated societal structures can follow when these factors converge to form two important criteria. Motashari's report says that all societal collapses over the past 5,000 years have involved both the stretching of resources due to the strain placed on the ecological carrying capacity, and the economic stratification of societies into elites, the rich, and the masses, or commoners, the poor. The elite population restricts the flow of resource accessibility to the masses, accumulating a surplus for themselves that is high enough to strain the natural resources. Eventually, this situation will inevitably result in the destruction of society.
Elite power, the report suggests, will buffer detrimental effects of the environmental collapse until much later than the commoners, allowing the privileged to continue business as usual despite the impending catastrophe. Yes, that's what I've been saying for a long time. You see, even some eggheads agree with me. Well, I ain't no genius. This is obvious stuff if you look at it.
Well, maybe I'm somewhat of a genius.
Science will surely save us, the naysayers may yell. But technology, argues Motasheri, has only damned us further. Technology can rise the efficiency of resource use, but it also tends to rise both per capita resource consumption and the scale of resource extraction. So that absent policy effects, the increases in consumption often compensate for the increased efficiency of resource use. In other words, the benefits of technology are outweighed by how much the gains reinforce the existing overburdened system, making collapse even more likely. Yeah, well, this is a failure of our system of plutocracy and how it stagnates social and technological advancement for their continued profit streams of pure greed and malevolence. I mean, it's just sickening. We still let these people rule us from the shadows. They are freaking demonic sociopathic rats. Face the facts, and let's change the damn system, people. All right, it goes on. The worst-case scenario predicted by Motasheri are pretty dire, involving sudden collapse due to famine or drawn-out breakdown of society due to the overconsumption of natural resources. Yeah, well, you should include climate change in there, buddy, and it gets even worse. The best-case scenario involves recognition of the looming catastrophe by elites and a more equitable restructuring of society. But who really believes that is going to happen? Yeah. Okay, egghead. That's the only possible scenario, right? I hear this a lot, and I'm so sick of it. What about the possibility of us running the elites off a cliff with pitchforks? No one can ever envision a people's revolution and then using rationality, science, and technology in a humane way to govern our societies, huh?
No, that's impossible, Vince.
It's not impossible. It's easy. And it's our only hope. Now, let me try to get through a little more of this before I get too sick of this crap. I mean, they always compare this to the Roman and Mayan collapses, always assuming we can't take power away from the elites in time to change anything. Well, that's BS. We don't have to repeat the past. We control our destiny, and they act like it's not even our fault if we don't change it.
It's just the way it goes,
because history is all they can associate with. And I guess the elites have superpowers and we just can't defeat them, huh?
Well, I guess in a way they kind of do have superpowers of mind manipulation and perfected propaganda. But, you know, we can overcome that. Well, perhaps not in time to save our habitat, but better late than never, mofos!
Historical collapses were allowed to occur by the elites who appear to be oblivious to the catastrophic trajectory. Most clearly apparent in the Roman and Mayan cases. Ah, see, I knew it. Well, all our plutocrats know what's coming. And they don't care. And they have fancy holes to hide in if a nuclear winter is a contingency plan. Well, here's a good paragraph from the article. Economic growth is the biggest destroyer of the ecology. Those people who think you can have a growing economy and a healthy environment are wrong. If we don't reduce our numbers, nature will do it for us. Everything is worse, and we're still doing the same things. Because ecosystems are so resilient, they don't exact immediate punishment on the stupid. All right, enough of that obvious egghead babble. Now, all we care about, and all that you know, Trump can brag about, is that the stock market is booming, and we still pretend economic growth is unlimited within this disaster economy, racing us towards inevitable collapse. But we can change what we base our economy on. And we can be rational about population exceeding the Earth's carrying capacity. And, you know,
population reduction, which was once implemented by the Chinese, you know, they said, one kid is enough. That's all you get. They even reversed that now, and they want to grow their population. I mean, things must change within our entire species, but we must start right here, right now. All right, I think this is a good time for me to play a clip from someone who I admired so much. He recently passed a couple years ago, and this clip, he's about 94, maybe 95 years old, and he was just a wonderful, brilliant man. Perhaps I admire him more than anyone else, and he really had an impact on my life. So listen to Jack Fresco for a couple minutes, will you please?
I'm an industrial designer and a social engineer. I'm very much interested in society and developing a system that might be sustainable for all people. First of all, the word corruption is a monetary invention. That aberrant behavior that's disruptive to the well-being of people, while you're dealing with human behavior. And human behavior appears to be environmentally determined, meaning if you were raised by the Seminole Indians as a baby, never saw anything else, you'd hold that value system. And this goes for nations, it goes for individuals, for families. They try to indoctrinate their children to their particular faith and their country and make them feel like they're part of that. And they build a society which they call established. They establish a workable point of view and tend to perpetuate that. Whereas all societies are really emergent, not established. And so they fight new ideas that would interfere with the establishment. Governments try to perpetuate that which keeps them in power. People are not elected to political office to change things. They're put there to keep things the way they are. So you see, the basis of corruption is in our society. Let me make it clear. All nations then are basically corrupt because they tend to uphold existing institutions. I don't mean to uphold or downgrade all nations, but communism, socialism, fascism, the free enterprise system, and all other subcultures are the same. They are all basically corrupt. Patriotism, weapons, armies, navies, all that is a sign that we're not civilized yet. Kids will ask their parents, didn't you see the necessity of machines? Dad, couldn't you see that war was inevitable when you produce scarcity? Isn't it obvious? Of course the kid will understand that you were pinheads raised merely to serve the established institutions. We're such an abominable, sick society that we won't make the history book. That just say that large nations took land from smaller nations, used force and violence. You'll get history talked about as corrupt behavior all the way along until the beginning of the civilized world. That's when all the nations worked together. World unification, working toward common good for all human beings and without anyone being subservient to anyone else. Without social stratification, whether it be technical elitism or any other kind of elitism, eradicated from the face of the earth. The state does nothing because there is no state. Because there is no state.
That's right. There is no state. We govern ourselves. We can be rational and smart about it. Oh, God love the guy. Such an inspiring man. There's so much more I could play from him. You should look into him. He's a great guy. Jack Fresco, everybody. I love the guy. All right, well, real quick, I want to talk about the mismanagement of social media because that is the point everyone is missing, you know? Like, there's clickbait YouTube videos out there saying something like, we must quit Facebook or you'll die, you know? I mean, it's a voluntary surveillance system for the CIA. I know that. And I'm sure they think I'm a bad guy and they have their eyes on me. And, you know, it's probably not good to publicly be known as a rabble-rouser. I agree, it's a terrible thing also for some youngsters who are on it way too much, and they're losing the value of true friendship and connectivity, and people who use it for some weird form of social acceptance and become shallow and depressed, that's bad, you know. I even get a little discouraged and down when, you know, what I think is a great, informative, poignant post, and I get 3 likes, and then someone gets 100 likes for a stupid picture of their dog, or one sentence in bold letters of something so obvious, and they'll get 100 likes, and no one will read my crap. But, you know, it doesn't have to be that way. We don't have to get goofy on it. I thought it should be a platform for organizing grassroots resistance and giving alternative information that you can't find in the mainstream. That's why I use Facebook. And, of course, that's what they don't want it to be used for, you know? There's a major effort to censor things on Facebook, you know? They don't want you to read about vaccine injuries and what's in them and anything about it. They just want you to believe what the freaking mainstream says. Even that horrible event that happened in New Zealand. And let me just say, my heart goes out to those poor people, the families of the victims there. It must be horrible what happened. You know, there are 50 dead Muslims were shot by some goofball. But, you know, Facebook's saying, oh, we don't want anyone to see anything about it. We're trying so hard to erase everything. So they don't see, because I guess the guy freaking, you know, had a live video feed going, and they want to make sure no one can see that. I don't know why. Yeah, it's gruesome and horrible. We should be outraged, but why do you have to be, you know, censoring everything? Are we little kids? You know, that's how they treat us. We can't see certain things, so we're going to scrub it from the internet. You assholes, just freaking leave us alone. Let us look at what we want. Let us form our own opinions. It's not going to lead to more killing, I don't think. Oh, look, I see this guy killing people. Now I want to do it. I don't know if there's that many sociopaths in the world that really would. I mean, certain things you got to be careful about, but don't censor the whole freaking internet. I'm sorry. I just totally forgot what the hell I'm talking about. But let me express my condolences to those people in New Zealand, and what a horrible event. And quickly, I want to mention economic professors, you know, because I hear them out there speaking, telling us what's going to happen and giving stupid solutions. And I got to say, I don't like them because they only see the system as something that works, not as something that must end, you know, incremental changes, all they can think of. And the lefty ones will say, if we just tax the rich more and raise the minimum wage, everything will be fine, you know, because the lower class will spend more money and create more positive economic activity. Really? How's that going to end the monopolies of the plutocrats and nefarious speculative activities and the stagnation of green technology? They don't want to admit that they spent way too much time studying a bad way to do things. That is unsustainable and hazardous to all life on Earth. And all they learned about has changed so much that it doesn't mean a thing anymore. You know, ever since Obama and the unlimited and ongoing bailout of Wall Street, quantitative easing since 2009. Everything's changed, dudes. What you think you know is worthless. Time to change the system. I mean, even a debt jubilee, which I heard one of them talking about, it ain't going to do it this time. We must be thinking of a better way to base our economy, and it's easy to do. You can't make this one work. It's done. Time to move on. We have to start the transition. Even if we don't get there, we have to start it for the kids. All right, I'm out of town for a week. You know, I'm trying to recharge my energy banks because I'm getting so frustrated in trying to write lately. You know, I mean, I do commentary for this show pretty well, but, well, I think anyways. But I'm so frustrated in trying to write a book in a third-party platform, and I feel so discouraged when I try to press on. It's almost like an outside force is making me discouraged by electromagnetic frequencies or something. So hopefully taking a week away from the old hole in the ground will help me refocus. Thank you for joining me on the Plutocracy Report this week. I'm Vince Marcanti, and stay tuned for the vinyl experience. I like it. He plays some cool tunes and gives cool info about them, too. Well, until next time, stay strong, stay healthy, and keep waking the sheepies. Until then, buh-bye.